Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Princeton Guide to Historical Research by Zachary M. Schrag, narrated by Peter Lerman. Introduction. History is for everyone. Historical research has been for me an area of joy and intellectual passion. I always feel a shiver of anticipation when I enter an archive or a rare book collection. What am I going to find? Natalie Zeman Davis, A Passion for History. In 2004, Afua Cooper walked the streets of Old Montreal, seeking the ghost of Marie-Joseph Angélique. 270 years earlier, Angélique, an enslaved woman, had been tortured and executed for setting a fire that burned much of the city. By telling Angélique's story, Cooper believed, she could tell a story about Atlantic slavery, about Canada's place in the Atlantic world, about an experience of woe and sorrow. Since much of the black past has been deliberately buried, covered over, and demolished, Cooper writes, it is our task to unearth, uncover, and piece it together again. This we are called to do because the dead speak to us. Not all history has been so deliberately buried, covered over, and demolished. Not all historical figures are silent ghosts. But, like Cooper, all historians believe they are called to unearth, uncover, and piece together a lost past. We remember what must not be forgotten. We tell the stories that must be told. These stories matter. 10 years before Cooper's walk, Roy Rosenzweig and David Thielen directed a telephone survey that asked 1,500 Americans how they engaged with the past. While a distressingly high proportion of respondents complained that their history classes in school had been boring and that they rarely read history books, a majority reported some kind of enthusiastic exploration of history through visits to museums, participation in hobbies, or, most of all, through the sharing of stories with family members. Using the past is as natural a part of life as eating or breathing, Thielen concluded. What we have in common as human beings is that we employ the past to make sense of the present and to influence the future. History making, insists Gerda Lerner, is not a dispensable intellectual luxury. History making is a social necessity. At National History Day competitions, students as young as sixth grade pose questions and share their findings. As they weave sources into stories, they engage in the same basic project as my colleagues in a university history department. Moreover, many of the contestants are perfectly capable of reading, understanding, and imitating some of the same works that I would assign to graduate students. Likewise, adults who do not think of themselves as historians take part in the great task. Over the years, I have worked with lawyers, architects, planners, engineers, ethicists, military officers, and other professionals, whether in the classroom, at conferences, or in oral history interviews. None has had any trouble understanding the goals of the historian or the importance of the work, and many have made significant contributions to the study of the past. Conversely, when I have worked with journalists, curators, public officials, and advocates to share some of my own findings in the form of newspaper stories, television documentaries, museum exhibits, or recommendations for public policy, I feel I have done pretty well at grasping their needs and making myself useful. I hope, then, that this book will reach historians from middle school through doctoral study and beyond, as well as those who identify not as historians, anthropologists, economists, geographers, political scientists, policymakers, sociologists, journalists, and nonfiction writers, but who want to answer questions about the past. One peril of any guide to research is that it will suggest that the process is more linear than it really is. Ski jumpers must perform their tasks in a set order: in run, takeoff, flight, and landing. If they deviate from this order, they have violated not only the rules of the sport, but the laws of physics as well. Figure skaters, by contrast, get to choose the order in which they will perform the various spins and jumps on which they will be judged. Writing history is more like figure skating in this regard. So long as you eventually perform all the tasks, the order is relatively unimportant. In point of fact, figure skaters get bonuses for moves performed later in their program. Please ignore this complication for the purpose of simile. In this book, I have tried to present the skills of the historian in what strikes me as a plausible order. In practice, you should expect to deploy these skills as needed, jumping back and forth, repeating some tasks, and skipping others. As William McNeil once described his process, "I get curious about a problem and start reading up on it. What I read causes me to redefine the problem. Redefining the problem causes me to shift the direction of what I'm reading. That, in turn, further reshapes the problem, which further redirects the reading. I go back and forth like this until it feels right." Two researchers with similar goals may differ widely in the tools and methods that produce the best results. One may work for an hour each morning, write a first draft in longhand, and never pause to outline or count words until they have a substantial bit of work on paper. Another may set aside one day per week for intensive work, starting with an outline, typing every word, and obsessively tracking progress. Some historians do not begin to write until they have gathered all the sources they think they will need for a project, transcribed key passages, and composed a complete outline. If that were the only way to write history, I would need to find another job. Even the individual historian must use multiple methods at different stages in a project. Sometimes you need to read a source closely, teasing out each nuance. At other times, you need to use outside information to put the source in context, or assemble hundreds or thousands of sources in order to discern a pattern. And just because one method works for one project, it may not work for the next. A work based mostly on primary sources has a different rhythm from one based mostly on secondary sources, and perhaps it demands different tools as well. Similarly, some projects, and some researchers, can take advantage of the very latest in computer technology and digital resources, while others will do just fine using methods similar to those employed by scholars hundreds of years ago. If a method works for you, it is not my place to challenge it. Rather, I hope in this book to document some of the methods that historians have used to pose and answer questions, to craft stories and arguments. Instead of telling you what to do, I hope to show you some options. Similarly, you should feel free to read the following chapters in whatever order makes the most sense to you. For example, reading the chapters on outlining and writing early may help you understand some of the chapters that precede them in the book. By learning the components of a finished work, you may have an easier time framing questions, identifying sources, and taking notes. This book mixes recommendations, I hesitate to call them instructions, with model passages from historians, showing various techniques in practice. As both a learner and a teacher, I have found such combinations effective, and I hope my readers will as well. If nothing else, I hope the examples show that most of the guidance in this book is not a set of arbitrary rules that I have devised, but rather a compilation of practices used by a wide range of historians across many genres and specialties. When judging the usefulness of my advice, do not take my word for it. Check the evidence I provide for its effectiveness. In selecting examples, I have tried to suggest some of the range of topics studied by historians, but I have not done so systematically. Instead, I have started with works I know I like, most of them about the history of the United States. Of course, each field of history presents its own challenge, and a general purpose guide like this is no substitute for mastering the existing scholarship on a particular topic and the tools that other scholars have developed to work with specific sources. But as I read the histories of other places and eras, I find most of the historian's tools to be familiar. I am therefore hopeful that the examples in this guide will prove useful far beyond the specific topics they address. I also hope that they will suggest some of the excitement of recent scholarship and inspire readers to track down the works from which they are drawn. Most of the examples are drawn from single-authored books, which have not only been a standard form of historical scholarship for centuries, but also give historians greater space to discuss research methods and sources than one is likely to find in articles, textbooks, museum exhibits, or other equally valuable forms of presenting historical knowledge. As argued in later chapters, the lessons of book writing apply to these other forms. A 10-page student paper or a 500-page book manuscript both need questions, sources, characters, plots, and arguments. And this guide aims to help creators find them. Moreover, as discussed in greater detail, books are composed of chapters, which themselves are often built from sections about the length of a 10 or 15-page research paper. Thus, if you want a sense of the scale of a topic that can be addressed in the length of a term paper, look for books with chapters explicitly divided into sections with their own headings. Then, consider the questions and sources the historian used to write each section. Analyzing how successful historians built their stories will make you both a better writer and a better reader. Researching history is like collecting stamps, sewing a quilt, solving a jigsaw puzzle, and reading a murder mystery at the same time. Like any human endeavor, it is at times difficult, boring, and frustrating. But when the research all comes together, it is deeply, deeply satisfying. Have fun. Part 1. Definitions. The term history threatens to mean everything, and therefore nothing. If, as the wildest champions of big history claim, history encompasses not only the study of everything that has happened in the past 14 billion years, but also the prospects for the next 5 billion, the term has lost some of its precision. At the very least, we need to distinguish between history as the events of the past themselves and history as the study of those events. This distinction is analogous to the difference between plants and botany, money and economics. Beyond that, it can be helpful to consider history as the study of people's choices. And finally, we can present history as a set of values shared by historians. Chapter 1. Defining History. Over the centuries, historians and philosophers have offered various competing definitions of history. Charles Beard, citing Benedetto Croce, called history contemporary thought about the past. Conyers Reid described it as the memory, recorded or unrecorded, of past human experience. Mark Bloch called it the science of men in time. Most historians could likely agree to definitions along these lines, all of which suggest that history is the study of the past. And yet, at the risk of presumption, let me offer my own definition, one that argues that history is not about the past, but rather about people. History is the study of people and the choices they made. Tips: ask not what happened, ask what choices people made. Answer questions by telling stories. Understand your work as part of an ongoing search for knowledge that began before you and will continue after you. History is the study of people and the choices they made. History does not include every study of the past, for, as Bloch observed, a great many events of the past belong to scholarly disciplines other than history. He offers the example of the siltation of an inlet centuries ago. Once there was water, now there is land. There is no question that this change took place over time, an event. Yet, had natural forces alone caused that event, the best scholar to explain it would be a geologist. Bloch next tells us that the people of Flanders had both assisted the siltation by building dikes and channels, and that they reacted by moving the harbor of Bruges. With that information, we are firmly in the territory of the historian, though presumably the geologist would still have valuable insights to offer. To be sure, historians care about the power of non-human elements, natural forces, technologies, commodities, to shape and constrain human action. But objects alone do not make history. According to its subtitle, Marcy Norton's Sacred Gifts, Profane Pleasures is a history of tobacco and chocolate, both inanimate substances. According to its introduction, however, it is the story of determined and frightened soldiers, zealous missionaries, resourceful plantation slaves, defiant Mesoamerican nobles, adaptive Indian commoners, mestiza love sorceresses, unsubjugated Carib Indians, cosmopolitan European humanists, crypto-Jewish Portuguese traders, lofty Sevillian merchants, worldly clergymen, scrappy sailors, reforming financial ministers, the patrons of smoky taverns, and the guests of well-appointed noble mansions. Now that's history. It is perhaps more controversial to insist that history is the study of choices, but I would argue that the interest in choice distinguishes history from the purely descriptive work sometimes done by archaeologists, demographers, epidemiologists, and other students of the human past. I am well aware that practitioners of these fields are often quite interested in the choices people made. When historians read words, they want to understand why people chose those words. When historians examine artifacts, they want to understand why people chose to create, acquire, and perhaps discard those artifacts. When historians trace pathogens, they want to know how people understood disease and how they tried to prevent it, heal it, or infect others. Norton wants to know why Europeans chose to adopt tobacco and chocolate in the forms they did. Many historians focus on people's choices about what to do, that is, their actions. Thucydides sought to explain why Athenians and Peloponnesians went to war after a 30-year truce. And for centuries, historians focused on similar choices of statecraft. In the 19th and especially the 20th centuries, historians broadened their view to include a great many humbler folk. But these people also had choices to make. At what age to marry? What job to pursue? Should they stay home or emigrate to a new town or a new land? Learn to read? Other scholars study people's choices not about what to do, but about what to think and feel, their thoughts and emotions. These can be elite intellectual histories, such as questioning why Margaret Fuller embraced transcendentalism, or they can tell the stories of how large groups of ordinary people understood the world around them. Whether the subjects are near universal experiences, pregnancy, death, or new phenomena, electricity, nationalism, explaining why a person chose one path and not another is the work of history. In studying choices, historians embrace contingency, the belief that had people made different choices, matters could have turned out differently. The concept is perhaps most easily grasped in military history. Soldiers fight and die in war because they believe that their actions on the battlefield will determine the fate of nations. Historians believe this as well. Thus, in his epic history of the Civil War, Battle Cry of Freedom, James McPherson identifies four major turning points that could have led to the granting of Southern independence and a world unimaginably different from our own. Northern victory and Southern defeat in the war, he concludes, cannot be understood apart from the contingency that hung over every campaign, every battle, every election, every decision during the war. Contingency appears in other genres of history as well. Historians describe as contingent the meanings that people ascribe to mirrors and to wilderness, and the decision by some societies to maximize profit rather than equality. Why did slavery expand in the early national United States? Asks Adam Rothman. The expansion, he argues, emerged from contingent global forces, concrete policies pursued by governments, and countless small choices made by thousands of individuals in diverse stations of life. Similarly, Alan Brandt does not believe that Americans were destined to take up cigarette smoking. Without resorting to a set of fantastical counterfactuals, he writes, it is clear that the history of tobacco might well have followed different routes and taken decidedly different turns. Following the cigarette through the century offers a fundamental opportunity to evaluate the contingent nature of historical change. The opposite of contingency is determinism, the belief that a particular outcome was inevitable. Geography, technology, or some other non-human factor forced people to act as they did. Historians generally hate this. If a historian calls you determinist, you have been insulted. Closely related to contingency is the concept of agency, the power of people to shape the world in which they live. Historians have long attributed such power to princes and generals, but only relatively recently have they attributed agency to humbler people: women, defeated industrial workers, slaves. Even when constrained by those with far more power, they argue, these people could engage in small acts of resistance. As Naomi Lamoureux explains, many historians hope to show that ordinary people in some group, typically defined in terms of race, class, gender, or ethnicity, had agency, that their lives were not completely determined for them, that they had space to make their own choices. Historians do recognize that contingency and agency have their limits. No individual is powerful enough to snap their fingers and change the world. While Franklin Roosevelt could have done more or less than he actually did to better the conditions of African Americans in the 1930s, he could not have eliminated race prejudice by executive order. And he was an unusually powerful president. Most people have less power, less agency. History encourages us to be more compassionate toward individuals navigating few choices, writes Marcia Chatelain. And history cautions us to be far more critical of the institutions and structures that have the power to take choices away. The task, argues Frederick Logavel, is to balance out the elements of human agency, on the one hand, with impersonal forces, on the other, and to write history that strives to stitch together persuasively all the causative factors and to take into account their interaction. Or, as Karl Marx memorably put it, men make their own history, but they do not make it just as they please. They do not make it under circumstances chosen by themselves, but under circumstances directly encountered, given, and transmitted from the past. The tradition of all the dead generations weighs like a nightmare on the brain of the living. History is a means to understand today's world. As Louis Gottschalk noted in 1953, historians have long debated whether it is more important to understand the past in its own setting, to appreciate history for its own sake, or to understand the past in order to throw light upon the present. Some historians seek to expunge present concerns from their work. Obsession with the events of the moment prevents the historian from exercising the faculty of empathy, the faculty of describing how people, like us, but different, felt and behaved as they did in times and places similar to, but different from, our own, Oscar Handlin argued. The writer or teacher interested only in passing judgment on the good guys and the bad will never know what it meant to be an Irish peasant during a famine, or the landlord, an Alabama slave in the 1850s, or the master, a soldier at Antietam, or a general. Perhaps, but as Handlin surely knew, without interest in, if not obsession with, the events of their own moments, historians would not have begun to care about Irish peasants, Alabama slaves, and other people previously neglected by historians only interested in the powerful. Other historians embrace the present. The creative historian lives a double life, writes John Higham. Responsive on one side to the questions and issues of his own age, faithful on the other side to the integrity of an age gone by. Today, some historians, including those who may not identify primarily as historians, work in that tradition, studying history specifically to extract perspective on the present. Historians of sexuality study the past in part to understand the range of human behavior and to suggest ways that sexual minorities might achieve liberation. Historians of medicine explore ways that previous generations understood physical and psychiatric ailments, in part to remind current practitioners that today's diagnoses are not the only ones we could imagine, and that older conceptions of disease can help us, both doctors and patients. Economic historians study wage gaps over history, in part to explain why they persist today. And knowing that some judges seek to interpret the Constitution based on what they believe to have been the conditions under which it was drafted, legal historians and legal scholars document those conditions. Introducing a book about presidential impeachment, published during investigations of President Trump's conduct, Jeffrey Engel admits the obvious. You are most likely reading this book because of impeachment's contemporary salience, he tells his reader, and also because you realize history matters. I don't see a bright line between past and present, notes Thomas Segrew. It's a fallacy to see the present as somehow uprooted from history. The opportunities and constraints that we experience in the here and now are the result of historical processes, and the world in which the historian lives will inevitably shape their scholarship. For better or for worse, today's cutting-edge history becomes tomorrow's relic. In 1949, Conyers Reed argued that history has to be rewritten for every generation. We ask different questions of the past from those our fathers asked, emphasizing considerations which our fathers ignored, and ignoring considerations which our fathers held to be of paramount importance. The older historians move in never-ending march from our studies to our attics, and from our attics to our dustbins. For today's historians, Reed's gendered language is further evidence of his point. By writing only of fathers and not mothers, he himself took a step up toward the attic. Historians' debates are not simply academic in either sense of the word. They are neither confined to the university nor irrelevant to decision-making. Stories of the past can comfort us or they can challenge us. They drive debates over museum exhibits, the naming of roads and buildings, the selection of school textbooks, and, most prominently in 2020, the pulling down of monuments to men who have expanded or defended slavery. Historians challenge collective national narratives, expose wicked deeds by national heroes, and generally attack the notion of a good old days to which we might return. Many historians cannot escape the political implications of their findings, even if they wish to. Nor can politicians escape history. As Seth Kotler and Richard Ellis argue, U.S. leaders spend so much time making historical claims and manipulating historical symbols that we should consider the president the nation's historian-in-chief. With or without historical knowledge, decision-makers are apt to reach for historical analogies. Ideally, they will have a range to draw from. You always benefit from knowing more history, notes political scientist Gary Bass, than when you go through the world with only one historical example in mind and everything looks like Munich or everything looks like Vietnam. Thinking with examples can include asking, what is the best outcome we can imagine and what is the worst? How might this situation appear to other people involved? What did previous generations fail to anticipate, and what questions should we be asking to avoid the same mistakes? What human beings have done in the past, the enormous range in ways of living and possible actions, argues Natalie Zeman Davis, is a source both of hope and despair. We can draw hope from it in the sense that if things have been different in the past, perhaps we're in a position to make them a little different today, at least a little bit different. The most explicit efforts to use history to shape today's world are variously called applied history or public history, which the National Council on Public History defines as the many and diverse ways in which history is put to work in the world. In this sense, it is history that is applied to real-world issues. As historical consultants, museum professionals, government historians, archivists, oral historians, cultural resource managers, curators, film and media producers, historical interpreters, historic preservationists, policy advisors, local historians, and community activists, the Council explains, all share an interest and commitment to making history relevant and useful in the public sphere. Some public history projects, such as television documentaries or major museum exhibits, may be seen by millions, while others are created for a select few, perhaps even classified as government secrets. But all are designed to bring history outside of the purely scholarly debates among historians to people whose main concern is the world as we live in it today. History combines storytelling and analysis. One of the more tedious perpetual debates in history is the relationship between the thorough scholarship that populates specialized academic journals and the lively writing of the best-selling books sold at airport newsstands. The former makes more explicit analytical claims, while the latter seeks to tell a good story. Some critics are splitters, seeing a wide gap between these two genres, or whining that history professors have retreated from public debate into their own esoteric pursuits. I am a lumper, believing that the more scholarly and more popular works contain the same basic elements, just in different proportions. However devoted to proving a thesis, great scholarly history tells stories about people, stories with characters and conflicts, plots and outcomes. And every work of popular history has a thesis, though it may be implicit rather than stated, and evident more in the assumptions than in the text itself. The genres of scholarly and popular history remain close enough that many titles succeed in both realms, but not just any work of history can become a bestseller. In the United States, for instance, the market for popular history is dominated by stories about the United States, especially stories of war, murder, scientific discovery, disaster, and sports, with a heavy emphasis on stories about men. Popular historians can slip a great variety of issues into those categories, and a few have broken out with stories of commodity exchange or slavery that would have seemed not the best topic for a beach read. But a great many topics will work only for scholarly monographs or journals. While even the ablest writer would struggle to interest the mass market in some topics that fascinate specialists, it is every historian's duty to tell every story as dramatically and clearly as possible to their intended readers. If the scholarship is strong enough and the topic important enough, I require my graduate students to read some pretty awful storytelling. But I cannot do so without wishing that the author had learned a few lessons from more popular formats. The English words history and story both derive from the Latin historia. Only in recent centuries have the words gradually diverged to the point where we expect the former to narrate true events, while the latter can refer to either a fact, a newspaper story, or fiction, a short story. And even with this divergence, history still contains story, and with it the storyteller's imperative. Some histories are single stories, told from beginning to end. Others are collections of stories, all taking place around the same time. Either way, historians must answer the journalist's basic factual questions: the who, what, where, and when. And like other storytellers, historians bring these facts alive with character, setting, and plot. The human need for storytelling is not likely ever to go away, William Cronin reminds us. It is far too basic to the way people make sense of their lives, and among the most important stories they tell are those that seek to understand the past. But historical research is about more than telling a good story. And since the early 20th century, some historians have termed their efforts scientific. They do not claim that human events are as predictable as the orbits of the planets. Rather, they use methods comparable to those who study the natural world. This is especially true in matters of scholarly communication. Like chemists and physicists, as well as sociologists, literary critics, and epidemiologists, academic historians immerse themselves in previous scholarship, cite their evidence, and submit their work for peer review. Sometimes they even get grants to conduct their research. Like scholars in those other fields, they hope that by following standard procedures of research and writing, they can create a shared base of knowledge greater than any individual could achieve on their own. And like the sciences, history can even be predictive. I do not mean that in the sense that it predicts the choices people will make in the future. Historians believe in contingency. Rather, it is predictive of future findings. Paleontologists do not predict what life forms will emerge in the future. They predict what kinds of fossils will be found in various strata in different parts of the world. Similarly, historians can predict what ideas and events will be found in sources similar to the ones they have reviewed. For example, Hidetaka Hirota read the words of 19th-century opponents of Irish immigration in New York and Massachusetts and found that they despised the Irish for being paupers. This finding does not constitute a prediction that in the year 2045, opponents will condemn immigrants for being poor, though that is the way I would bet. Rather, it constitutes a prediction that if another historian does their own research using additional sources, one will find similar claims. And indeed, Hirota's analysis helped me understand the arguments of nativists in Pennsylvania, which was beyond the geographical scope of his study. Thus, he predicted what I would find. Historical claims are rarely capable of objective proof, as might be the case in math or physics. Rather, the goal of the historian is to persuade readers that the argument set forth helps make sense of the choices people made in the past. Not every reader will find a given claim equally persuasive, and you do not need to persuade every reader in order to have achieved success. Success comes with enlightening the readers whom you care about the most. History has been called a science, an art, an illustration of theology, a phase of philosophy, a branch of literature, proclaimed Charles Beard in 1933. It is none of these things, nor all of them combined. True, some historians deny the variety of their discipline and insist that every history must be analytical or narrative, or literary, or national, or transnational, or long-term, or popular, or public, or expert, or profitable, or open access, or patriotic, or transgressive. In fact, however, historians as a group write in a range of voices, as do individual historians. Even a single historian working on a single research project may share their findings through articles in specialized journals, a book for fellow scholars and interested laypeople, and contributions to museum exhibits, documentaries, and journalism that reach far larger numbers. Choices about topic, the scope of a project, the research methods used, and the means of presentation generally demand trade-offs. And it is not obvious whether it is more important to forever change the minds of the 12 leading experts in a subfield or satisfy the mild curiosity of 5,000 readers outside the academy. As a reader, you should be able to identify a historian's own goals for their work and to appreciate that work on those terms. As a creator, what is important is that you set goals for yourself and shape your work to achieve those goals, and that you periodically reassess what it is you are aiming to achieve. History is an ongoing debate. Like other scholars, historians reject the notion that a question can be settled forever, however brilliant and scrupulous the researcher. We are constantly discovering new sources, posing new questions, considering new contexts, and suggesting new ideas about the past. Historians routinely revisit events previously studied by others, believing that old versions of the past may no longer serve today's needs. There can be something unsettling about seeing today's historians reject previous interpretations, since it implies that today's interpretations will soon lose their value. Why work so hard to produce a product so ephemeral? In practice, however, the best interpretive debates produce not stalemate but synthesis. In 1989, Lawrence Levine wrote of historians, "Confidence that although we might operate in cycles of historical interpretations, the general movement was upward toward an increasingly sophisticated understanding of the past." And even when interpretations grow too stale to use, basic factual findings endure. I have relied on the work of historians who wrote decades ago, whose conclusions I may question, but whose research I trust. I would like to think that whatever they think of my own interpretations, future historians will learn something from my own factual discoveries. Historians enjoy tracing the history of their own enterprise, retelling the clashes between conservatives and insurgents, the expansion of the discipline from a study of past politics to a wider exploration of human experience, the rise and fall of such approaches as psychohistory and cliometrics, the entry into the profession of women, ethnic and religious minorities, and people of color, and the waxing and waning of historians' influence on popular culture and public policy. Even the definition of historian is fluid. At the start of the 20th century, the term embraced people who today might use other titles, archivist, political scientist, or teacher, even as they pursue historical knowledge. Yet for all this, I am more struck by the continuities in the history of historical research than I am by the changes. Today's historians write of topics that might have baffled Edward Gibbon, 1737 through 1794, or Henry Adams, 1838 through 1918. Yet they tell their stories in ways that Gibbon, Adams, and even Thucydides and Tacitus, writing thousands of years ago, could recognize. And they do so in the same confidence that writing history is a core function of any civilization. The most innovative tools work best when combined with more traditional approaches. For instance, a computer algorithm can help answer questions, but older methods of posing questions and searching archives still have great value. The same continuities appear when historians ask new questions. Even those who wish to overturn existing histories can do so using established tools. Jean O'Brien, White Earth Ojibwe, for example, has shown how 19th century New England historians misled readers about their region's native past and denied the continued residence of Indians in their states. Yet, she bases this critique on her own meticulous research into primary sources preserved in archives. Rather than rejecting the methods of previous generations of historians, she deploys them with a different perspective and greater skill than her predecessors. In the spring of 2009, I spent some time at the Library of Congress exploring notes taken by David Maydole Madison, a historian born a century before me. Decades earlier, Madison had started work on a never-completed history of riots in the United States, a subject that interested me as well. He had worked with steel pen, ink, and paper. I had a laptop computer and a digital camera. Yet, despite the apparent revolution in technology, my task was not much different from his. Reading through old newspapers, magazines, books, and official records, taking notes, and hoping to synthesize those notes into a coherent story. We can still learn from the age of the note card and the age of the microfilm reader. In this guide, I hope to highlight general practices that come to us from those earlier periods, and despite future changes in both scholarly focus and technological capacity, will endure. Chapter 2. Historians' Ethics. In addition to being defined by its goals and methods, history is defined by the values held dear by its practitioners. The bespectacled scholar, carefully turning the pages of a yellowed newspaper or scowling at a peer reviewer's unkind comments, may not seem particularly fearsome, but the collective enterprise of history can sway jury verdicts, build or destroy reputations, and even send nations to war. And as members of a profession, historians shape the careers and lives of students and colleagues. Cognizant of this power, historians' associations have crafted codes of ethics. The American Historical Association's Statement on Standards of Professional Conduct is a particularly useful starting place, but historians should also seek more specialized codes and ethics discussions that are relevant to their work, such as those concerning oral history, public history, local history, archiving, and other such fields. While all historians share some fundamental values, they work in a range of situations. The ethical freedom enjoyed by a tenured professor may be out of reach to a consulting historian on contract to a business firm, but the latter should still maintain some firm limits. Ethics evolve in response to new situations and debates. For example, in the 21st century, historians, librarians, and archivists pay increasing attention to the respectful use of culturally sensitive Native American archival materials, to the provenance of rare material that has been displaced by purchase or war, and to the benefits and perils of making primary sources and new scholarship freely available on the Internet. Perhaps, then, historians' first ethical obligation is to understand that historians have ethical obligations, and to educate themselves appropriately. Tips: ask honest questions and be open to surprises. Avoid falsehoods by showing your work. Care about people, living and dead. Curiosity. The first virtue of the research historian is curiosity. If you already know the answer when you begin a project, you are not doing research. As noted later in Chapter 3, historians form questions in many ways, and they must keep their minds open as much as possible. Like researchers in other fields, historians must avoid confirmation bias, the tendency to ignore evidence that challenges one's beginning assumptions, and to highlight evidence that reinforces them. Confirmation bias can creep in at any stage of a project, framing the question, establishing a research design, taking notes, or writing up findings. It is the force that allowed generations of male historians to ignore the women in the stories they were researching, and generations of white historians to downplay the horrors of slavery. It has also tripped up individual scholars who have become so entranced by what appears to be a wonderful story that they ignore their doubts and twist evidence to fit their preferred narrative. We cannot identify all of our biases, and future generations of historians will delight in pointing out the limits of our imaginations. But we can attempt some self-awareness and look for evidence that complicates the narratives that we have inherited. Professional integrity in the practice of history requires awareness of one's own biases and a readiness to follow sound methods and analysis wherever they may lead, insists the American Historical Association. Historians should not misrepresent their sources. They should report their findings as accurately as possible and not omit evidence that runs counter to their own interpretation. Accuracy. To praise a historian for his accuracy is like praising an architect for using well-seasoned timber or properly mixed concrete in his building, wrote E.H. Carr in 1961. It is a necessary condition of his work, but not his essential function. In reality, architects do gain praise for sensitive and innovative use of materials, and a great deal of the historian's work consists of finding trustworthy materials for their projects. Moreover, accuracy is a matter of degree. A simple traffic accident can easily produce contradictory eyewitness accounts, and larger historical events generate even greater discrepancies. Thus, even writing a simple timeline of what happened when can become an exercise in weighing evidence, and thus in interpretation. Historians aspire to tell the truth, writes Richard White, but we usually settle for avoiding known falsehoods, trying not to make unsubstantiated claims, and providing evidence for what we say so others can check for themselves. Historians who work with hundreds or thousands or tens of thousands of contradictory, fragmentary sources, some perhaps in a foreign language or produced in a time or place or profession that the historian has never directly experienced, do not expect to attain complete accuracy. Instead, as White suggests, the real standard is not accuracy but replicability, meaning that, as in laboratory science, a study can be repeated because a detailed study method's description is available. For scholarly history, this takes the form of quotations and footnotes or endnotes with citations to additional sources. When the stakes are high enough, it may be worth laying out alternative possibilities to the reader, either in the main text or in a discursive note. In exceptional cases, a historian might be asked to produce their working notes for a project. A commitment to accuracy also requires the admission of doubt, and sometimes the words, "I don't know." Factual accuracy alone does not guarantee good history. Facts do not select themselves or force themselves automatically into any fixed scheme of arrangement in the mind of the historian, argued Charles Beard in 1933. They are selected and ordered by him as he thinks. To select and order facts in a way that contributes to human understanding, the historian must embrace additional virtues. Judgment. My purpose is not to relate at length every motion, but only such as were conspicuous for excellence or notorious for infamy, wrote Tacitus early in the 2nd century. This I regard as history's highest function, to let no worthy action be uncommemorated, and to hold out the reprobation of posterity as a terror to evil words and deeds. 2 millennia later, Julia Late tweeted a similar sentiment. Being a historian is all about muttering, "You fucker," to long-dead prime ministers whilst alone at one's desk. Less judgmental historians can still help readers form their own conclusions. It is the function of the historian to keep before the people, with as much clarity as possible, the different lines of action that have been taken, the several, often complicated reasons for such action, and to point to the conflicts and inconsistencies, the contradictions and illogicalities, and the defects and deficiencies when they exist, argued John Hope Franklin. One might argue that the historian is the conscience of his nation, if honesty and consistency are factors that nurture the conscience. Others disagree. Block regarded passing judgment as a lazy alternative to explanation. How much easier it is to write for or against Luther than to fathom his soul, he wrote, to believe Pope Gregory VII about Emperor Henry IV, or Henry IV about Gregory VII, than to unravel the underlying causes of one of the greatest dramas of Western civilization. Historians must decide which people should be held accountable for their words and deeds. In his history of white Southerners' reactions to the civil rights movement, Jason Sokol names the segregationists who wrote letters to New Orleans Mayor de Lesseps Morrison. As citizens, they were taking part in a public debate and writing to a public official. But Sokol treats differently the essays written by University of Georgia students who were asked by their calculus instructor to record their views on integration. These students did not write for public consumption or to be published, Sokol explains. For these reasons, their names need not be disclosed. He does provide initials, allowing subsequent researchers to check his work. Oral historians may be the most tempted to pull their punches. When you like and admire the people you are interviewing, notes Valerie Yao, you are also subtly influenced in the direction of seeing things positively instead of realistically. Other historians have advised a sterner approach. to the historian all men are dead, insisted John Kay in 1870. If a writer of contemporary history is not prepared to treat the living and the dead alike, to speak as freely and as truthfully of the former as of the latter, with no more reservation in the one case than in the other, he has altogether mistaken his vocation, and should look for a subject in prehistoric times. Indeed, while the temptation to limit criticism might be greatest when you are writing about living individuals, similar pressures can face any historian whose findings might threaten cherished myths about families, institutions, or ethnic groups. Public historians may be tempted, even unconsciously, to write favorably about their employers. Like all bureaucrats, writes Marin Royce, at the time a historian for the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, federal historians are expected to enhance the power of the agencies for which they work. Agencies, sometimes consciously, sometimes unknowingly, occasionally pressure history offices to use history selectively to further agency programs. In some cases, historians may shy away from making certain claims in order to avoid legal trouble. In 2018, for instance, Poland passed a law, later modified, criminalizing some claims that the Polish nation or the Republic of Poland is responsible or co-responsible for Nazi crimes committed by the Third Reich. I could go on, but even as I write these words, I must weigh the consequences of the examples I could give against the chance of their tarnishing the reception of my research, interfering with my future travel, or increasing the likelihood of my being sued. Ideally, the historian acts without such fear, even knowing they may give offense. As a South Carolina caretaker in his 90s told Lonnie Bunch, "If you're a historian, your job is to help people understand not just what they want to remember, but what they need to remember." Empathy. Historians do their best to empathize with the people they write about, to understand their thoughts and deeds. Sometimes this is easy. You find a character whom you admire, whose arguments make sense to you. You still need to write about that person critically, but the task is pleasant. At other times, historical actors' decisions are baffling, at least at first glance. Whenever possible, historians try not to dismiss such actions as irrational, but instead keep working to find an explanation that makes sense to them. "Merely to talk of superstition and delusion explains nothing at all," writes J.B. Pierce of the Tosa peoples destroying much of their own food supply in the 1850s. "We have to try and understand why beliefs which seem to us, and to all Tosa now living, patently absurd and impossible, seemed logical and plausible to the Tosa of 1856. He proceeds to explore the internal logic, not only of the Tosa beliefs, but also of British beliefs, which he finds equally absurd and impossible. Obviously, historians write about some dreadful people, murderers, thieves, enslavers, war criminals. They are not bound to share the beliefs of the people they study, nor to forgive their crimes. But even if historians come to despise some of the people they study, they are bound to attempt to see the world through their eyes, and to try to explain their motives. Our goal is not to critically assess how Jefferson made his way through the world and determine what his life might or should mean for us, for better or for worse, what we think he ought to have been doing," write Annette Gordon Reed and Peter Onuf. "We instead seek to understand what Thomas Jefferson thought he was doing in the world." The greatest storytellers are those who humanize their villains. Satan, in Paradise Lost, is still Satan, but through Milton's telling, we get a sense of why he might have been so intent on defying God and corrupting humans. Historians, though working on a less cosmic scale, can learn from Milton's example. While communicating his disagreement with people, he manages to avoid painting them as hateful caricatures, writes a reviewer praising Timothy Lombardo's blue-collar conservatism. "He shows them as fully formed individuals with complex motivations, prone to errors in judgment, as we all are, but not deplorable or easily written off." Even when writing about people who are, in fact, deplorable, the historian's goal is to understand everyone as fully formed. This is not to say historians should limit their accounts to the actor's own understanding. The empathy of the historian, explains Lincoln Mullen, does not consist simply in retelling other people's stories for them. They can do that well enough for themselves. Rather, it consists in going beneath individual accounts to reveal deeper patterns of thought, word, and deed, in demonstrating to people that though they may have acted of their own will, yet they have acted within historically conditioned constraints. The empathy lies in demonstrating what it was possible for people to say so that they can better understand what they have said. Gratitude. History is among the more solitary pursuits in the academy. Scientists have their labs, archaeologists their digs, musicians their ensembles. Ethnographers always find someone to talk to. And many disciplines that could, in theory, be pursued by single scholars have developed traditions of co-authorship, with multiple authors on most articles. History, by contrast, tends to value single authors, especially for scholarly books and articles. And there are good reasons for this, especially when it comes to the authorial voice. That said, while a single name may be on the cover of a book or the heading of an article, historians work with other living people in a variety of settings. While some of the best interactions will be unexpected, it can be useful at the start of a project to think about who else will be involved. Because they depend on others, historians accumulate debts. As members of institutions, they get help from colleagues, mentors, and students. As people, they get help from family members, friends, and neighbors. And as researchers, they depend on other scholars, co-authors, funders, librarians, and archivists, editors and publishers, and ultimately, readers. Most obviously, historians, like all scholars, need to cite their sources and distinguish their contributions from the work of others. They must avoid plagiarism, copying others' words and presenting them as one's own, a topic discussed in greater detail in later chapters. But citing sources and attributing quotations are only the baseline. Good historians credit the aid they receive with explicit thanks not only in citations, but also in acknowledgement sections, public remarks, and mentions of other scholars' work in press interviews, or even casual conversations. One has many opportunities to plug other scholars' work, and historians try to pay forward some of what they have received by helping other scholars and all those who are interested in history. For instance, they seek out the work of junior scholars and historians from underrepresented communities, citing their work to make it more visible to others. Historians consume public resources. Whether we are fortunate enough to be paid directly for our work, through jobs and grants, or simply rely on publicly supported libraries and archives, or claim the time of experts and witnesses, we rely on our communities to help us with our work. In return, we have some duty to share our findings. Sharing can mean many things. It can mean writing in a style that is understandable and appealing to as many potential readers as possible. It can mean formatting websites in ways that work for people with disabilities, limited bandwidth, or small screens. It can mean choosing journals and publishers that price their products reasonably, or making at least some version of your findings available without charge. It can mean depositing datasets, interviews, and other materials in repositories for other scholars and future generations. And it can mean sharing findings in public lectures, school classrooms, and other open venues. You do not have to work for free. History is hard work and compensation is honorable, but historians should feel some duty to the society that supports them. Truth. We study history, wrote Lawrence Kremen, not because in its absence there will not be any history, but rather because in its absence we shall have a corrupt history. We shall have the myths, distortions, and ideologies that flourish in the absence of critical scholarship. Some people openly invent characters and events, setting novels and movies in the past. These creations can inspire people to learn the truth, or at least they can suggest that truth, even at the expense of some details. In other cases, works of art propagate dangerous misunderstandings about the past. As Gary Gallagher laments, "It is likely that more people have formed perceptions about the Civil War from watching Gone with the Wind than from reading all the books written by historians since David O. Selznick's blockbuster debuted in 1939. And those perceptions are not good. Gone with the Wind and works like it have led many Americans to believe that African Americans were content to be slaves, and that Southern enslavers began the war for some reason other than to defend their ability to keep enslaving. Worse still are those who spread historical myth without even the pretense of fiction. Whether it is a book by a television pundit who has cherry-picked a few facts to support a deeply misleading thesis, a facile historical analogy offered by a politician who knows nothing of the events they are describing, or a full-scale irredentist land claim or genocide denial that becomes national policy. Bad history imperils our ability to make wise choices. Thus, some historians explicitly define their work as demythologizing events. At other times, professional historians have added to the myth-making, letting their assumptions or politics cloud their judgment. Much as we might like to blame myths about Reconstruction on Gone with the Wind, its author, Margaret Mitchell, drew upon the dominant white scholarship of the era, and the William and Mary Quarterly praised her novel's historical accuracy. At such times, it can take a layperson or activist armed with better history to challenge the mainstream interpretation. As Selznick was adapting Gone with the Wind for Hollywood, civil rights leader Walter White advised him to read African-American historian W.E.B. Du Bois' Black Reconstruction as a corrective. In 1968, Thomas Bailey noted historians' culpability and argued that we historians have a special obligation to set the record straight and keep it straight. We cannot muzzle the poets, the playwrights, the pedagogues, the patrioteers, the press, the politicians, and other muddiers of historical waters. But we can, if we will, control ourselves. One of his proposals was a centralized myth registry for both articles and books. Then, with the marvelous data recovery processes now being perfected, the requisite information can be made speedily available on request. Such an agency should be a goldmine for teachers, researchers, and especially textbook writers, who have a heavy obligation to keep abreast of this verbal Niagara. Half a century later, in the age of the Internet, we know that marvelous data recovery processes are not the panacea that Bailey wished. Websites and social media disseminate falsehoods every bit as efficiently as they debunk them, and some of those falsehoods even make it into textbooks. Maintaining the centralized myth registry turns out to be exhausting, unending work for the historians of Twitter. As Melvin Kranzberg famously declared, "Technology is neither good nor bad, nor is it neutral. It is up to a technology's users to choose the good." Historians will never control a monopoly on the past, nor can they hope that the good history they write and share will drive out the bad. But there is honor in the effort. Part 2. Questions. The starting point of research in history, as in any other field of research, is a question. There is nothing more miserable than slogging through material that does not rouse your curiosity, and nothing more joyous than pursuing a question that truly excites you. Take time to frame your question, since it will drive the rest of the project. Once you have done so, you can craft a research design with which you can answer your question in the time and space available to you, and that will make others care about the answer. Chapter 3. Asking Questions. "What is that doing here?" asked an astonished Andrew Needham, spotting a vast coal-fired power plant as his family drove through the high desert of New Mexico. Years later, Needham would answer that question in his prize-winning book, Power Lines, Phoenix and the Making of the Modern Southwest. Above all else, historians must learn to ask questions about how the world came to be and stay curious for as long as it takes to get the answer. Biologists write of life cycles of the species they study, tracing their progression from gametes to juvenile to adult forms, which in turn produce more gametes. History projects grow the same cyclical way, so historians can jump in at any point in the cycle. Start with the seed of an idea, nourish it through its delicate early stages, watch it bloom into full maturity, and if you are really lucky, perhaps collect seeds for the next generation. Or start with the adult, then collect its seeds. Or start with the juvenile and nourish it into adult form. Questions lead to answers, but answers lead to questions as well. Secondary sources may steer you to primary sources, but those primary sources spark questions that you can answer most easily by consulting additional secondary sources. The research process resembles a climb up a spiral staircase, in which upward progress depends on your circling back to a spot near where you were before. Still, since this section of the book must start somewhere, let's start with an early stage in any project. Wonder. Tips. Choose topics that spark your sense of wonder. Start with a question, not a thesis. Frame your question using dialectics. Wonder. How did you get interested in that topic? It is a question every historian hears, and it is often a good one to ask. Not only does it frequently elicit an entertaining tale, but it can also reveal something important about the way the historian's mind works and their aims in tackling a particular subject. It can also be a question historians ask of themselves as they lift their tired eyes from the sources and try to recall how they got there. And while every answer is unique, a few basic patterns appear again and again. Autobiography. Walter Prescott Webb once described his monumental book, The Great Plains, as an autobiography with scholarly trimmings. He began it at the age of 4 when my father left the humid East and set his family down in West Texas, in the very edge of the open, arid country which stretched north and west farther than a boy could imagine. Webb was hardly the first or the last historian to draw inspiration from events and settings in his own life, and a great many works of history could be described as autobiography with scholarly trimmings. Some historians write about events that they themselves witnessed or even shaped. Before he wrote his history of the Peloponnesian War, Thucydides commanded troops in that war. Before they wrote their 10-volume Abraham Lincoln, A History, John Hay and John Nicolay had served as Lincoln's secretaries. Ruth Rosen, a veteran of the women's movement of the 1960s, writes about that movement with scholarly rigor, yet she also slips into the first person to give readers a glimpse of her own participation, such as engaging in an effort to take over a Berkeley radio station. Other historians write about their ancestors. John Hay's friend, Henry Adams, defended the reputation of his grandfather, John Quincy Adams. Winston Churchill wrote biographies of his father, Lord Randolph Churchill, and his more remote ancestor, the first Duke of Marlborough. Winston's son, Randolph Churchill, in turn published 2 volumes of a biography of his father and was working on more at the time of his death. More recently, Catherine Mulholland has written a biography of her grandfather, engineer William Mulholland, and Stephen Carter has written of his grandmother, an influential lawyer at a time when few African-American women practiced law. As Catherine Mulholland acknowledges, the reader may doubt the objectivity of such accounts, but that same reader should read all historical accounts critically, regardless of their author's ancestry. Even when an ancestor is not a major character, they can inspire and inform a work. My father came home every morning from his graveyard shift at a plywood mill covered with industrial glue, his shirt stained purple, writes Eric Loomis. Scars crisscrossed his arms from a lifetime of wood splinters cutting his skin. Those scars, as well as his father's love for the outdoors, influenced Loomis's empire of timber, labor unions, and the Pacific Northwest forests. Alexander Avina was inspired by his uncle's kidnapping and disappearance to study the history of Mexico's drug wars and other violence. Years before she published her history of anti-Chinese violence, Beth Lou Williams heard her grandfather's story of being detained as a 9-year-old boy on Angel Island. Ned Blackhawk and Timothy Lombardo relate snippets of family history, in part to suggest their sympathy with the communities whose histories they tell. Tara Hunter starts Bound in Wedlock with a photograph of her great-great-grandparents' marriage certificate and her family tree. Some historians write not about biological ancestors, but ancestors in spirit, people who shared the historian's experiences or passions. In the 19th century United States, for instance, historians working or studying at Catholic universities and publishing in Catholic journals wrote histories of the church and Catholic communities that remain superb resources today. In the 20th century, they were joined by members of various racial, ethnic, and religious minorities, as well as by women, all of whom brought new perspectives about the communities that had produced them. As a child immigrant to the United States from Cuba, Lillian Guerra faced discrimination at school. "History was how I grasped for straws of cultural and racial dignity when fellow second graders denigrated my slightly flatter, decidedly non-Anglo nose, relatively hairy limbs, and propensity to tan a dark brown rather than bake into a bright, bubbly red in the Kansas summer sun," she later reflected. "Why did they think being blonde was better, I wondered?" In her works on the history of the Caribbean, she has both answered questions and asserted her worth. Paul Longmore survived polio as a child and advocated for disability rights as an adult, experiences that informed both his studies of the American Revolution and his histories of disability. "As both a professional historian and a person with a disability," he explained, "I have explored how cultural values, social and political ideologies, and social processes shaped individual and collective identities, and how revolutions in ideas and institutions redefined those identities." Professional training in other fields, or even an intense hobby, can complement historical training. We have wonderful military histories by veterans, legal and medical histories by historians who also have degrees in law and medicine, and histories of technology by historians with engineering backgrounds. In other cases, formal degrees matter less than lived experience. Adrienne Hood spent years working as a weaver before enrolling in graduate school to research and write about cloth rather than make it. Though her book, The Weaver's Craft, tells the story of weavers who worked centuries before she did, her passion for textiles and her knowledge of looms no doubt helped her write their story. James Longhurst, a dedicated rider and restorer of bicycles, drew on those experiences when writing Bike Battles, A History of Sharing the American Road. Other historians try to understand the places in which they grew up. Elizabeth Cohen's A Consumer's Republic, The Politics of Mass Consumption in Postwar America, is a national narrative. But throughout, Cohen returns to her home landscape of suburban New Jersey, even including a photograph of herself at age 4. None of this is to say that the historian must have a family or personal connection to the people they write about. In the 1960s, Carl Breidenbaugh was appropriately denounced for suggesting that historians of lower middle class or foreign origins, that is, Jews, find themselves in a very real sense outsiders on our past, and therefore lacked an understanding of the American past somehow common to those who grew up in rural America. Sometimes an outsider's perspective is exactly what is needed to ask new questions and find new answers, and to correct the accounts by insiders who may have, however unintentionally, written history to glorify their own group at the expense of others. And while personal experience may contribute to one's historical research, it is no substitute for the research itself. Everything has a history. We have been puzzled for a while about how salt and ground black pepper became the standard spices on the American dinner table, wrote two readers of Cecil Adams' column, The Straight Dope. Why don't we use cinnamon or oregano or something else instead? The learned Adams replied, "This is just the kind of thing that fascinates historians, gang, something you may want to consider next time a historian asks you out for a date." Indeed, asking about the origins of things we see around us, from table condiments to institutions to persistent causes of conflict, is one of the most common inspirations for historical research. In 2015, James Grossman, executive director of the American Historical Association, coined a slogan for the truth underlying this approach: "Everything has a history." Tracing the histories of elements of today's world may be the most common form of historical research, simply because it is a necessary step in so many fields. As Grossman notes, politicians, economists, doctors, and journalists, if they have any sense, explore the history of a problem before seeking to explain or solve it. When a company plans an initial public offering of shares, its prospectus likely offers a rosy history of the company's founding. When a commercial airplane catches fire, the National Transportation Safety Board explores the work history of the crew and the manufacture history of the defective part, as well as the events that took place once the fire began. Historians, too, get curious about things they see around them, like Andrew Needham. Environmental historians William Cronin and Timothy LeCain mention first encountering the sites of their later scholarship, Chicago, the Berkeley Pit, on family trips. The Statue of Liberty has a history, as does the Grand Canyon. Cynthia Kerner was inspired not by her first encounter with the Jersey Shore, but rather that landscape's sudden devastation by Superstorm Sandy in 2012. Which led her to investigate concepts of disaster in the past. We not only have histories of salt and pepper, but whole series of commodity histories, explaining how now common foods and other products became objects of mass production and consumption. And we do not need to stop with places or physical objects. Ideas, too, have histories. When did people first conceive of the idea of the middle class, of pollution, of immigration as a problem? Policies have history. When did Americans start providing poverty relief, and why did they attach such a stigma to it? Economic structures have a history. Thomas Piketty opens Capital in the 21st Century by observing that the distribution of wealth is one of today's most widely discussed and controversial issues. But what do we really know about its evolution over the long term? Even common human behaviors have histories. As she lay on the delivery table, having given birth for the first time, Judith Walzer Levitt imagined a history of women's experience of childbirth. Further along in parenthood, Peter Stearns watched his slouching children and realized he had not chastised them the way his father had chastised him. When, he wondered, had Americans abandoned the stiff postures of their ancestors? If your mind is prepared, every waking moment can inspire a research project. Narrative expansion. What happened next? What happened before? What did events look like from another character's point of view? How might these events have played out in a different setting? These are questions that occur to many lovers of stories, some of whom make the effort to craft additional stories themselves.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.